Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out. I am very excited about this event because I've been a fan of Michael's for a long time. And so now I get to grill him in front of all of you. I will confess, however, that when I was asked to do this Q&A, I was like, Michael Ian Black, love him, a memoir, comedian, joke, sounds great. And then I read the book and it turns out it's about your body and how it falls apart and the evanescence of life and really death. It's about death, but with jokes, which makes our conversation perhaps slightly more somber than I had anticipated. But it's very impressive, I think, how you've pulled off the combination of a comedic memoir that's really a meditation on death.
What if, and this may be the case, I don't know, what if you had read it and didn't like it at all, you'd still be saying the same exact things.
I can couch my words very carefully. It's one of my skills. I'm very diplomatic. So I could, but I did really like it. So luckily, here we are.
All right. Thank you.
You can keep scrutinizing me to see if I'm faking it throughout the evening, but I think you will find I am not. I wanted you to talk a little bit about how you focused in on the subject of the book. It's called Navel Gazing, and it starts very literally with a story about a navel, and particularly your mother, who ended up without one after surgery for cancer. What prompted you to take up this topic?
Well, my mom got sick a while ago with cancer, as you say, And then, but that was, in a weird way, that was almost the least of it, because after that, her health just continued and continues to just deteriorate. And so it's been a kind of long slog of illness. And then I think I did what a lot of children do when faced with that kind of situation, which is you go, how can I make money off of this? And so I had finished with my last book, well, 2 books ago, but my last memoir called You're Not Doing It Right, which is about relationships, like romantic relationships. And I had talked a little bit about my mom, but not that much, because I don't have a romantic relationship with my mom. But I knew at some point I kind of wanted to tell her story a little bit, because she has, I think, a compelling story. And I also sort of felt like, and continue to feel like, she could just die at any minute. I mean, it's just, she has horrible health. And so that provided some urgency. And then, but I didn't feel like I could just write a kind of biography about my mom, because I felt like that would be weird and probably not a book. And I needed to sort of insert myself into that and kind of what I was going through simultaneously. And that's a roundabout way of answering your question.
One thing that's really striking about it, so you talk a lot about your mom and your childhood, and I want to talk more about that later tonight too, but you also talk a lot about sort of aging and your own body and how both aging and your mom's sickness make you want to get in shape. It struck me, I don't feel like we read that many men talking about their bodies in that way. I mean, I think there are people who write articles for and read Men's Health and Men's Journal magazine.
But it's a different thing.
I don't know those people. And and yet you're very, it's like a very familiar mode from memoirs that women write. I mean, you cite Nora Ephron, I Feel Bad About My Neck, and talk about your feet, which you feel bad about. But was it a strange mode to be in, writing as a man in that mode? Were there precedents that you were looking towards where
no,
other people had
fact,
done that?
No, in fact, it was very deliberate, because I feel like male vanity is something that people don't talk about, because there's something sort of it's almost taboo in a weird way, because I feel like the culture feminizes men who care about how they look. I mean, you're sort of looked at as fey, or as I wish I could think of the word that I'm It's not a bon vivant, but it is a...
A fop?
A what?
A fop? A
fop is exactly the word I was looking
All
for.
Right.
A fop is exactly the word I was looking for. That's why I went with fey, F-E-Y, a three-letter word beginning with F.
Got that vowel in the middle.
Fop is... you're sort of looked at as foppish. But the truth is, like, every man I know is vain, but nobody will talk about it. Nobody talks about, except in the sort of most sort of joking way, about hair loss or weight gain or any of those things. And it speaks to a kind of male insecurity and a way that men have a difficult time talking about being men in the culture. And as I've gotten older, I've learned that there's, like, all of my work is about that in certain respects, is about how to be a man and having no idea. And so having to carve out my own path for being a man. And part of it for me is about asserting that there are different ways to be masculine and to be a man and to be okay with that and to hopefully give other guys permission to be okay with that.
It really feels kind of radical. I mean, you think about people reading, this may seem like a grand comparison, but like the feminine mystique and people talking about things.
It's not grand, that's exactly the right comparison. I think my book will be remembered.
I'm sad that you didn't send it to me for blurbing, frankly. This is a missed opportunity. But it is really striking to see that. I'm curious about how your relationship with your mom changed. I mean, it sounds like writing the book gave you an excuse to ask her a lot of questions and have a lot of conversations. Did it change during the writing of the book? And or what did she think when she read the book?
I don't think it changed. I think we've always been close, and we've always been able to have conversations. It gave, as you said, it gave me an excuse to ask her things that I wouldn't normally ask her about, like her sex life, which is not something that I would recommend any boy asks his mother about. But yeah, I mean, it definitely brought us closer. I think she liked talking about her life. I think any parent feels flattered when a child wants to know about their lives, because I'm a father of two, and you know, children are solipsistic in that way, that they don't think the world existed before they existed, and I was certainly guilty of that in regard to my parents. So I think it was nice for her to feel like she was sort of imparting some of her hard-won wisdom onto me. And I was a little nervous about her reading the book, because I say some unkind things about her. Not a lot, but some. And she loves it. She loves the book.
That's great. You don't seem unkind to her. You seem honest but very loving, I think.
Well, that's how I intend it to be, but one, she could easily have read it as unkind.
I see that. These are the kind of enticing details I'm dropping to make. I guess they've already bought the book, because that's what they're here.
Maybe they're on the fence, and this is what they're using to judge.
Didn't they like have to buy the book to be sitting in this room?
No, apparently you can also buy a $15 store credit to attend.
All right. If you bought the store credit and you're on the fence about the book, the exact nature of the unkind things he says about his mom are the kinds of things you can only find out if you read it. I'm not going to divulge them here. One thing that you talk about very movingly is this conversation that your mom had with you and your brother that felt at the moment like some kind of parting, perhaps final, I love you, and how awkward and not in the moment you felt about it. And you describe it with real emotional honesty, and it's a really amazing scene. And then you talk about how when you die, you want to pull your kids close and say, what's the exact phrase?
I think it is, I will pull them close and whisper in their ears, you know, I think you're both assholes, right? and I say, and if they laugh, I will know I have done my job.
I wanted to ask you a little bit about humor and parenting, because there's a lot of very funny exchanges between you and your mother in the book, and you also talk about the joys and exasperations of raising children, and because I also have two young children, can relate. But what's it like to be a comedian and a parent? Like, how do you deploy humor with, for, and against your children, and how do you think about that?
Well,
and what are the odds you think they will get that joke at this point? Like, how's it going?
At this point, they'll get the joke. Most of my humor with them is, this is going to sound awful, is literally like telling them they're assholes. Like, that's most of my humor with them, is saying to them, you know, I love your brother more, or that sort of thing. But they've gotten to an age where, you know, they understand that that's hilariously funny.
How old are they now?
I don't know how old they are. I mean, 12 and 14. I never really thought about my profession in terms of parenting. I mean, for the first, let's say, 7 years of my son's life, in the first 5 years of my daughter's life, I was too miserable to inject much humor into our relationship at all. Just because just little kids are such a pain in the ass that it was all we could do to just hang on to survive. I mean, you've got 3-year-old twins now.
I do.
That sounds awful to me.
It's busy.
See, that's great. The other thing most people won't say. It is awful. Most parents won't say that. But it is. It's awful when you have little kids. I mean, it's great, too, but it's awful more than it's great, I think.
I'm not sure I'm with you on that one, but there's definite awfulness.
Well, you have better kids than I have.
Until I ruin them. I'm curious, so you've written, this is your second memoir, and you've also written some children's books, and you've also done stand-up, and you've also done sketch.
I wrote a political book, too.
And you wrote a political book, too.
And I wrote a book of essays, funny essays.
And probably some other stuff.
I wrote some other stuff, too.
Yeah. But I'm curious about how writing for memoir feels different, or how your process is different than writing jokes, either stand-up or sketch. You know, there's so many great lines in here. I love, there's one line where you describe, well, one of the things that happens in the book is that Michael gets very interested in running, which definitely is terrible. You describe at one point after a long run your legs being as pliable as willow branches, which is just such a great description of how your legs feel after you run, and is why I don't do it. But like that's such a great line. Is a line like that a line you would use in sketch, a line you would use in comedy? Like how does the writing process differ for the different forms?
My answer will be pretentious, but that's only because I am pretentious. I write these books, memoirs and such, as a way to learn how to be a better writer. Like, to me, the goal of writing these books is really just to learn how to write. And so, because I didn't study it, because I don't really know any writers, the last thing I wanted to do was write a celebrity memoir. And believe me, I use the word celebrity advisedly. But that is the category that I am probably most likely to be put in, alongside, you know, Chelsea Handler and whatever. And those books are fine. But I had no interest in sort of breezy, joke-filled sexcapade or showbiz stories or any of that. Like, I really wanted to write books. And so a line like, my legs felt as pliable as willow branches or whatever, to me, I would never use that kind of term in sketch comedy, because it's not that funny, but it's descriptive. And so I just want to be a good writer. Like, that's all I really care about. And so I you know, like, for these memoirs, like, I almost feel obligated to make them funny in some way, even though, just to make them readable. But I guess that's part of being a writer, is to make something readable.
Yeah. No, I mean, humor is not just for the comedy stage. But it's not like you weren't writing before. I mean, comedy,
no,
writing is writing.
It is writing, but I wanted to be a writer of prose. Like, I really wanted to learn how to write prose.
So what do you feel like you learned in this book or the previous one? Like, what were there ticks or things that you were doing?
Well, in the previous book, I was writing too many jokes because I didn't trust that anybody would care. And in this book, in the early drafts, I wasn't writing enough jokes because I was too confident that people would care. So it's about finding the balance.
Next book, you will have it perfect.
Next book will be perfect.
You heard it here first. I'm curious also to hear you talk a little bit about stand-up versus sketch, because I feel like there's a hidden war in our culture between the improv people and the sketch people.
You do?
And the stand-up people. Kind of. I don't know. If you listen to Marc Maron, it feels like they're all at odds.
Jesus Christ. Marc Maron is at war with everybody.
That seems true, but it does feel like there are these different schools and camps and brigades of comedians, and like the processes are different.
No.
All right.
No. You'd think so. I guess I could see from the outside thinking that would be the case, but it really isn't. Maybe it used to be different. I don't know, but I feel like the world of comedy is very generous to other comedians. It may be because we recognize how difficult it is, and so when people do it well, from whatever their background is, I think there's a lot of appreciation, whether somebody is a stand-up background or a sketch background or an improv background. I don't think it matters. I mean, you know, Upright Citizens Brigade, where Amy Poehler comes out of, they were an improv group, and then they had a sketch show, and you know, they're friends with me and my friends, who are friends with like Paul Rudd, who's an actor, who are friends with all the stand-ups. You know, it's like it's a pretty big incestuous world, and you know, if you're gonna have sex with your relatives, you better like them.
Yeah, I guess I don't actually believe that it's all like the battle scene from one of the Anchorman movies, but it does feel like there are different modes of thinking about comedy.
Well, there absolutely are, but if you're looking at Marc Maron as as the arbiter and judge, I think you could do better. I love him. I don't love him. We have a relationship that is tense, and he's very smart and probably thinks about these things more analytically than other people. And he has a vision of stand-up as a very pure art form, as opposed to... Basically, he has a vision of himself as a very pure artist, as opposed to everybody else who has been corrupted by society. And so if you're not specifically him, you are impure.
I think it's the reverse, which is there's a self-loathing.
Oh, God, yes.
Where he's like, everyone else seems so productive, and like they're all friends and they all get along in these big group things, and I'm a lone artist.
He's a loner because he hates everybody, not because everybody hates him.
Fair enough. Speaking of...
No, I want to talk about Mark Maron more.
How many fun comedy friends you have, and how popular you are in the comedy world, unlike Marc Maron. Can you talk a little bit about what
you
it
want
was...
me to name drop? I will. I already said Amy Poehler and Paul Rudd. I'll do more.
I want you to talk
Amy
a little
Schumer
bit.
Amy Schumer is a dear friend.
And J-Law as well.
Through extension, yes. By extension, J-Law is a dear friend.
Transitive property of dear friends. It looked really fun to make a remake of, or a whatever the thing was called, the second one, had American Summer.
Yes, a prequel.
A prequel TV season of a movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, I feel better about grasping for the term. And it also struck me as funny because part of the original joke of Wet Hot American Summer is that you guys are all too old to be campers. And then the secondary joke of the remake prequel is that you're even older. But it actually kind of goes in with the theme of your book of all of those people's aging bodies. So can you tell us something about how old you felt with those people, or how young you felt, or what Bradley Cooper is insecure about with regard to his body?
I know. To my knowledge, Bradley Cooper is correctly... insecure about none of his body, then that seems right. It was fun. I mean, we knew going in. I mean, look, we're all in our 40s playing 16-year-olds. So there were, you know, there was no like, do I look old in these shorts? We knew we looked old in the shorts. And that was part of the fun. So I don't think anybody was particularly insecure, except perhaps for Michael Showalter, who had put on approximately 100 pounds between the movie and the TV prequel. He did. He's not here, right?
I honestly couldn't tell if that was like costume.
A joke? If he had gotten into like a fat suit every day to shoot the prequel and like spent hours in makeup doing that?
I was genuinely somewhat perplexed.
All right. We all were.
Never mind. All right.
Because it's not like it snuck up on him. It's not like he didn't know we were going to be shooting this.
Did you have a Wet Hot American Summer workout prior to shooting?
Yeah, I think you can answer that question yourself.
All right. Was it? Were there any other things that were particularly fun about being back? People who, like the ways that the particular jokes seemed different based on all the comedic experience you guys had had in the years between?
I think we all just felt a lot more comfortable just professionally. I mean, we all have 15 more years of experience just doing the job, so it just ran a lot smoother, which was great. You know, it was fun when we were in our late 20s shooting it. It was more fun, I think, when we were in our 40s because there was so much less alcohol.
That makes sense. I thought you were going to say it because comparatively the rest of your lives are less fun, but maybe that's just...
No, me. I'm happier now by far than I was then.
One question I wanted to ask you was about how many different modes you work in, and also it feels like comedians have to work in these days, but you're so fun and aggressive on Twitter. I feel like you have a very fun Twitter persona.
Thanks.
And I was delighted and surprised to see you in the piece in the New Yorker this past summer about Megan Phelps. Did you guys read this story? This is this young woman who was raised in the Westboro Baptist Church and fervently believed all of their homophobic beliefs, and then appointed herself kind of the social media, young social media czar, and started tweeting out hate on Twitter. But then on Twitter, she encountered the rest of the world. And the story was this great story about how that changed her. But you're like the first person. You're like the, you know, the hands touching across the divide. Do you take full responsibility for her entering the world?
I saved her soul.
She tried to save yours, but she was so wrong. Why are you the way you are on Twitter?
Well, Twitter for me is my life's primary procrastination tool. It is what I do when I should be doing anything else. So I will spend all day there instead of doing work or doing anything. So by necessity, if you're going to spend that much time on Twitter, you should probably have something to say. And I often don't, but I do sometimes get on a soapbox on Twitter, and I try to do it in a funny way, but not always. And it has been my main sort of political outlet because, look, what am I going to do? Join something?
You could, I mean, there's a lot of people running for president these days.
I think I'm a little late, and I'm not a natural born citizen. That is not true. I am a natural born citizen, but it seemed like a good excuse as I was thinking about it.
In case you guys were thinking of the draft black initiative.
I would make a very bad politician. I know that. Because I don't, because like the thought of like, hey, you know, this weekend we're gonna, you have to go march in the parade through the little town and wave. Be like, no.
It seems like publicly evincing exasperation with the process is working for Trump, though, a little bit.
I will happily divert this entire conversation into a Trump conversation if you want.
I spend too much time talking about Trump already. I think part of what's interesting to me about you working in so many different modes is I feel like you have...
Are you counting Twitter as a mode?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Don't you think?
Yeah, I do.
Do you have like a Twitter persona that's a little different from your in-person persona, that's a little different from stand-up self, from memoir self?
I have many personae on Twitter.
Oh, even within Twitter there's multiple personae.
Yes.
Describe the personae.
The sanctimonious lefty. That is my truest self. The naif, the sort of wide-eyed naif who doesn't understand.
Are you being a real naif or a faux naif?
I'm being a faux naif. The faux naif. the arrogant guy. The conservative. Sometimes I'm a conservative. Like a hardcore conservative.
Wait, what? On what?
Well, just like, I mean, it's all sarcastic, obviously, but like being angry at Obama for getting the prisoners in Iran home, like being angry at him about that and not going to war with Iran.
So that's just sarcastic, sanctimonious lefty.
Yeah, but I try to craft it in such a way that if you didn't know me, you might think that it was sincere.
Okay. Got it.
And there's more. Sports guy know-it-all.
Also faux or real?
Oh, totally faux. I don't know anything about sports.
How do you feel like your sort of stand-up and comedy personas differ from your memoir persona? I mean, I know you talked about the kind of writing you're interested in doing, the subjects you're interested in doing, and more or less jokes, but you still have sort of a self-deprecating self-presentation even within the memoir.
I do, because I write so many personal things. And in these books, it's about people that I care about, and it's hard to make them the butt of the joke. So I have to make myself the butt of the joke, or else I look like just the biggest asshole in the world. So I'd rather just the joke be on me, so that's why I'm constantly self-deprecating in the books.
But is that different from the style? Like, do you do less of that elsewhere?
No, I do more of it on stage. But let me just say, that's also not calculated, but it's also conscious in the sense that I get resentful of memoirs in which the writer is the hero of some grand adventure where he's always making good choices and showing the world what fools they are. And I feel like I read a lot of that, as a corollary with that, often in books about like relationships and things, the writer sort of does the thing of, oh, what a buffoon I am, and how did I get so lucky as to marry this angel who's with me? And I feel like that's just as bad or worse, because it's sort of elevating somebody to these sort of inhuman standards, and so or superhuman standards, and so I try to like paint my wife the way my wife is, and I try to paint my mom the way my mom is, and I try to paint myself a little bit worse than I am in the pursuit of trying to say, look, we're all flawed, we all do dumb things, we're all just people, and we love each other.
I think it works.
Thank you.
In the book. How are we on time? Time for some questions? All right. Who has questions? Is there like a mic process?
Raise your hand. People and need I'll to know try about? To.
You probably don't need the mic to ask a question. You just speak.
You could
in
also
a clear,
just speak.
Wise tone of voice. The first one's always the hardest. I know. Nobody likes to raise their hand. Thank you.
Are there any memoirists
I admire? I read so few memoirs. I read almost none. I'm trying to think. Honestly, my favorite one, I don't even know if it's a memoir, and this is going to sound so hokey, is Eat, Pray, Love. I love that book. I loved it. I gobbled it up. And it's not at all like my book, but I like it a lot. All right. Favorite type of role? They're like profitable ones. My favorite thing that I'm doing right now is this show Another Period on Comedy Central, where I play a butler named Peepers. Mostly because I don't know that I ever would have cast myself in that part, and the fact that the creators of the show, Natasha Leggero and Ricky Lindholm, saw me like that and just said, hey, will you do this, I thought was really nice, and I honestly feel like I'm doing a really good job with it, and it's fun to play something like, I have no problem playing gay. I have a problem with only being cast as the gay guy, which is 90% of what I'm cast to do. So I'm very happy that I'm playing a straight, uptight, early 20th century butler. Hi.
I missed your podcast, but I read that you just interviewed David Sedaris, and I was just wondering how your views on
Right. I did start a literary feud with David Sedaris.
You write about it in the book.
Mm-hmm. It's going well in the sense that he still doesn't know that we're engaged in a literary feud. I did not. I really should have talked about it on the podcast. I interviewed him. That's what she was asking about for my podcast, How to Be Amazing. And I'm not the amazing one. The guest is the amazing one. Yeah, I don't know why I didn't bring it up. I think I was a little afraid, but I shouldn't have been because he would have found it funny.
Also, you told everyone else in the world about it in the book you just published.
But he must not have read your book.
Oh, God, no. He doesn't read my books. He barely knew who I was. But he's the only person that I'd interviewed so far that had actually heard the podcast, which I thought was strange. Not strange that nobody else had heard it, strange that he had heard it. And so that's why he did it. And so it was really great to talk to him. He's a lovely guy. And exactly who you think he is. Whatever you think he is, that is who he is.
Are you going to have Tucker Max on your podcast?
I would. It's a good question. I challenged Tucker Max to a fist fight. When I was promoting my first book, this was after my literary feud with David Sedaris had gone so well. I tried to up the ante by challenging. Do you guys know who Tucker Max is? If you don't, he is now reformed, a writer of like.
He's like a mega bro.
Yeah, he wrote that book, I Hope They Serve Beer in Hell, where it's just what I think are mostly made up stories of him. Getting drunk and having sex with drunk people who then, one of them will then throw up on the other one or shit on the other one or some version. And the books were runaway bestsellers, of course, huge bestsellers. And I was number two in the Amazon humor category and he was number one. And I thought if I challenge him to a fist fight, I will then become number one. And it did not work out that way at all. Because first of all, he accepted the fist fight, but accepted it totally seriously. And I did not mean it totally seriously. I had no intention of ever fighting Tucker Max or anybody, but he really wanted to have a fight. And I backed out of that in the most cowardly way imaginable. And that was the end of that. But now he's like reformed and is writing books about how to like get the girl of your dreams and be like a man and be like the man that women want you to be, like that kind of thing. And I'm like, you're such a sellout.
I don't know. It seems like you guys could both have a very productive conversation about modes of masculinity.
We probably could.
You got to get him on your podcast.
It's actually a very good idea, but I'm afraid that he would hit me if he saw me. Because he has vowed to do that.
You gotta do it and want it. You gotta do it like Terry Gross does it.
All right, over an ISD line.
Yeah. So he's in some other studio, and then you talk very soothingly, and you tell him to have a chance to do it over later.
That's a good idea. I also want to have the Phelps girl on.
Yeah.
Megan.
Megan Phelps.
I want to have her on, and she said she would do it, but she lives in North Dakota, so she's the Westboro Baptist Church gal. She said she would do it.
That'd be great.
Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
As the mass, like, kind of the cult of fans with Stella and Stella and whatnot, were you worried when you first started writing books that only those people would buy books?
Did you hear the question? Was I worried that only the people who like the State and Stella and things would buy the book? I guess so, but I was really hoping to find a new audience. In addition to, not as a substitute for. And I trusted that if the books were good, people would read them. That seems to not be the case with this current book. I don't think it's selling well at all. Oh, well.
Wait, really?
I don't know why people don't want to read about my mom's cancer.
You get scared before you publish a book or go on stage or
do I get scared before I go on stage or publish a book? Yeah. Terrified about publishing a book, certainly. Going on stage less so because I know I've done the jokes before most of the time. And so I know what's strong and what's weak, and I know what needs work and what doesn't. With a book, you know, you really only have one chance to put it out there. And yeah, it's very scary. Also, because I work harder on the book than I work on anything else.
Is it also different? It feels like if you're doing a performance, you can like modulate midstream based on response, and the book, you kind of just...
Yeah, you just shit it out and hope that it's warmly received. Hope your shit is warmly received. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
You had Lin-Manuel.
Oh, yeah.
As a guest before Hamilton showed up, have you had a chance to see Hamilton?
I have not seen Hamilton, much to my chagrin and embarrassment. And that is, at first it was due to laziness when it was at the Public. And I was like, oh, I'll go see Hamilton. And I really wanted to, but the thought of like, you know, like there's certain things I can't do. Like getting tickets for something is one of those things. Scheduling a colonoscopy is another. I know I would enjoy Hamilton more than I would enjoy a colonoscopy. And yet, I did not get the tickets. I did interview him before Hamilton. And I knew, I was sort of being coy on the podcast. And I was saying, this sounds like it could be the biggest, like the worst idea in the world, when he was describing his hip-hop musical of Alexander Hamilton. But I was being a little bit disingenuous because I had seen his performance of the opening number he did at the White House when it was still sort of under construction, not the White House, the number. And I knew it was going to be really good, and I suspected it was going to be big, but I did not have any inkling that it would be like this.
Wait, this sorry, you saw that at the White House?
I was not at the White House. I saw a YouTube clip of it.
I thought you just were casually dropping that.
No, he was at the White House, and I was watching the clip while I was at the White House.
Got it. Good. I'm glad we have that cleared up. Of all of the amazing people that you've interviewed for your podcast, who is the most amazing so far?
It's an unanswerable question. They're all...
Come on.
Most of them do vastly different things, and so I'm not being diplomatic. I couldn't pick one.
All right. Who presented a moment of amazingness or a fact about their amazingness that was most striking or surprising to you?
The thing that always I always hold in my head is I interviewed Mike Massimino, who's an astronaut. And he described his first trip going into space. And when the astronauts leave from their like holding pen, they have like a quarantine to go over to the shuttle. They get driven in a van, and they're holding their like, they have like life things, like things they have to carry. But in addition to that, they carry their lunch. Like literally like a brown paper bag of lunch to take up in the space shuttle. And that to me is like the best possible image for what creativity is. You know, it's like, it's just your bag lunch, and then you're getting in a space shuttle and going up into the world. You know, it's like everything is just it everything you can do just gets distilled down to this brown paper bag, and that's what the work is. It's the bag, you know. And then before you know it, you're in front of a fucking space shuttle.
All right, answer extracted.
Something like this that's super personal. Compared to, I know you've also done like children's books. What's the difference in the experience?
The difference in terms of experience and motivation between writing a book for adults and writing for children, it's I think of writing children's books now like writing sketch comedy. Like to me, that's all it is. It's just writing a sketch, and it's writing a sketch for kids. And if I spend more than, let's say, 90 minutes or 2 hours writing a children's book, I haven't done my job. And that's what I do. I'll just dash them off. I don't write with a quill pen. And I don't write from right to left, like in Arabic. I should. They would be better books. But to me, they're just like these fun little things that I do. And I try to get them, I mean, in subsequent rewrites, I try to get them right, but I would be lying if I said it was hard or I spent a lot of time on them, because I don't. The people who really spend time on them are the artists who have to illustrate them.
Are you, as someone who reads a lot of children's books at the moment, were you more motivated when you wrote your first one by the fact that there are truly great children's books out there and you thought you could make one, or by the fact that most of them suck and you're like, I could write a much better book than that?
It was most of them suck and I could write one at least as terrible as the ones that I'm reading to my children. Oh, go the fuck to sleep. Great. I feel great about it. I'm resentful that I didn't write it. It wasn't as like mind blowing as I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be a lot harsher than it is. But it's funny. It's funny. Do you like it? Yeah, it's funny. I wish it had been even more hateful.
Is there anyone in the comedy world right now that you haven't worked?
Anybody that I haven't worked with that I really want to, well, not really. I mean, the thing is, like, it would be the people that I really admire. I don't feel like I'd be at my best if I worked with them because I'd be intimidated. Like I did one day on a Judd Apatow movie on This Is 40. And I was so excited to do it, but I didn't feel like I was at my best because I was so intimidated by being with Judd Apatow. So it was fine, but it's more fun for me to just work with friends who I feel like I can just kind of be myself, and then hopefully my friends get more famous and hire me to do stuff.
Is it hard to transition back and forth between writing yourself and then writing with other collaborators?
No, I mean, they're different jobs. Writing by myself is I was going to say pleasurable. It's not. It's but it feels like the sort of purest writing that I do. And then writing with other people, it's generally just jokes and writing funny things and coming up with funny stories. And that's just sort of lighthearted and fun. It's all the same to me. It's all kind of the same.
When you're asked to write a book, or publisher say you want to write a book, do they kind of tell you what they want, or you just like, I have this idea?
I say to them, this is what I want to write, and then they either buy it or don't. They've bought it every time so far, but I don't think it's a given that they will, particularly if book sales continue the way I think they're going. I know. Thank you guys so much. You may be the only people who buy it. You had to. I know. Great. I don't give a shit. I don't give a shit why you bought it, as long as you buy it. I don't care if you read it. It doesn't matter to me.
How do you keep perspective since you came from a group with the state? Like, how do you keep perspective on your career as people around you and close to you are at different stages of their career? Like, and you do so many different kinds of things. Like, how do you keep perspective on what success is?
The question is, how do you keep perspective on what success is, particularly in light of coming from a group in which the state, in which various people are sort of rising and falling with the various tides. And in fact, it's that rising and falling that helps me keep perspective, because I've now been doing this long enough that I recognize that to maintain a career in this business, your career absolutely has peaks and valleys. And my definition of success has changed a lot over the last few years. I no longer crave the same kind of success that I may have when I was younger. And I certainly haven't made life choices that would lend itself to the kind of commercial success that I thought maybe I wanted when I was younger. Now, all I want to do is do things that are either fun or pay a tremendous amount of money. So, for example, I have a game show that premieres tomorrow on Pop called The Easiest Game Show Ever. Paycheck. Total paycheck. Fun, but a total paycheck.
Wait, what's the conceit? Why is it easy?
It's really not that easy. It's a series of true-false questions about pop culture, and people wrongly assume that I give a shit about pop culture because I was in the I Love the 70s, 80s, 90s shows. And they think, oh, this guy really loves pop culture. No. I'm so detached from pop culture. I mean, I feel like I know a lot just because I'm on Twitter all day, but I don't care about it. But it's pop culture questions featuring teams, one team of two people who bicker about whether something is true or false, and then I kind of make fun of them and give them money.
So you're like the Alex Trebek type.
Yeah, I'm the host. Yeah. I'm the host, but with jokes. I make more jokes than Alex Trebek.
All right. Hard, but I like it.
Other but questions? Just watch it because I need it to stay on the air.
Other questions?
How closely do your children follow your work? What do they understand about?
I think they, at this point, they understand exactly what I do, and they don't care at all, which is as it should be, I think. I certainly don't come home and say, Daddy's really famous. A, because it's not true, and B, because it would be a dick move. They don't care. And that's how I prefer it. I don't talk to them very much about just... I mean, I tell them what I'm doing, but I don't present it as anything other than this is what I'm doing. And hopefully they don't think of it as anything other than that. Yeah, why not?
Why do you think you're happier now?
Why am I happier now than I was when I was in my 20s? Because I'm on medication. That helps a lot. Also, I think... just maturity. I mean, I just think I think it's true for most people. You get happier as you get older. I'm just more comfortable being myself. I feel like I have a sense of who I am now, and I feel like I was maybe a late bloomer in that regard. Like I feel like I didn't really know myself at all till I was in my mid 30s. Like it, or I didn't know my full self. I'll say that. What I'm trying to say is I'm transitioning. I'm to a woman. I'm going to be... I'm just happier. I don't know. Are you?
I'm not so sure.
How old are you?
I'm 40.
Go
my friends are not.
Oh, some of your friends are not? Are they getting divorced?
No, they're kind of sticking it out.
They're sticking it out, and that's why they're unhappy. Do they have young kids?
Yeah.
That's why. No, really. I mean, having young kids, I think, is the toughest part in anybody's life. Certainly in a marriage, it's the hardest part of a marriage. And then, yeah, as the kids sort of grow up a little, you get so much happier because they just don't need you in the same way. And it just relieves a lot of stress in the house. It's very hard having young kids. I know we've talked about this before.
That's why I asked the question of were you happier then instead of now. I was maybe projecting.
You'll get happier. Yeah.
Do you ever get to the point with Twitter where it just like really, you feel like it's really affecting you, it really gets you down?
I don't feel like Twitter gets me down. I get down, I just get in my own head and I'm like, I have to put this away. I just get sick of my own voice. I get sick of my own voice anyway, but then sort of I get sick of myself on Twitter pretty quickly. So yeah, I have to put it away. Hi.
What's it like to be a woman in comedy?
What's it like to be a woman in comedy? I feel like I can answer that question. It's hard. It's really hard. Good question.
Are you still friends with Megan McCain?
I am still friends with Megan McCain.
What does she really think about what's going on with the Republicans?
Well, what does Megan McCain really think about what's going on with the Republicans? I don't want to speak for her, but I will.
she hates it. She hates Trump. She hates Cruz. I think she feels like I feel, which is that the Republican Party has run itself into a ditch, and it's going to be very hard for it to pull itself out. We may disagree as to why that happened. I would argue that it happened because the Republican Party steered itself into a ditch. But yeah, I mean, she's really passionate about the Republican Party, feels incorrectly like it's a good party, and I think she worries about its future. I also worry about its future, only because as much as I dislike most of what they stand for, I am a proponent of a two-party system, because without that, I think you have bigger problems than what we already have. So, yeah, I think she's concerned.
Well, if there aren't any other questions,
there might be. You just shut off the conversation. But you want to transition.
I do. I'm excited for that part as well.
Yeah, that's gonna
but
be super
seriously,
exciting.
But seriously, are there any other questions?
This gentleman.
Yeah.
Has
okay.
One.
Go for it.
You have a beautiful voice.
Did your wife have any input at all into what you wrote? What made it to a final product?
My wife, the question was in my previous book, which is largely about my wife, did she have any input into the final product? Yes. I said, I'm going to write a book about our relationship. She said, no, you're not. I said, yes, I am. And she said, I have veto power. And I said, no, you don't. So she had veto power. And surprisingly, there were two things that she objected to, one of which I can't share, one of which was easy enough to change, and the other one, because it just was about somebody that she didn't want me to say something about somebody, and she was right. And the second thing was she got really mad when I told the story about we went to Amsterdam on our honeymoon, and I said that we went to a little cafe, and I ordered a crepe with ham and cheese, and she ordered a crepe with banana and Nutella, and she said, you have to change that. I would never order a crepe with banana and Nutella. You ordered the crepe with banana and Nutella. That's what a child would order. So I'm like, if that's your biggest objection, I think I'm gonna be all right.
Last call, anyone? All right, well, thank you so much to both of you for being here.